Welcome to this discussion on the future of education as part of the Australian Leadership Series. I acknowledge the elders past, present and emerging of First Nations people across the lands from where we are all joining today. The topic today is specifically a strategic response to the challenges for Australia's education sector with internationally famous guest, Professor Brian Schmidt, who was one of Australia's most renowned Vice-Chancellors, leading the top-ranking research and higher education institution, the Australian National University. Many of our international guests will, however, more likely recognise Professor Schmidt as a brilliant scientist and certainly one of Australia's most eminent astrophysicists and scientists in general. He was the winner of the 2011 Nobel Prize in Physics, among many distinctions and awards accrued. It seems timely to remind everyone of what the Nobel Prize winning discovery was, which involved identifying that the expansion rate of the universe was accelerating. Now, for those non-scientists who may have learned of this important scientific discovery during the pandemic in one of the many lockdowns around the world, they might have had a difficult time apprehending the fact that the expansion rate of the universe was actually accelerating. Right at the time, most people were sitting through lockdown with a distinct and felt experiences of their worlds dramatically contracting. I digress. Professor Schmidt was made a companion of the Order of Australia in 2013 and is a fellow of the Australian Academy of Science, the United States Academy of Science, and the Royal Society. We will begin with a presentation from Professor Brian Schmidt and then proceed to questions. May I also encourage viewers and all those listening in to write in their questions through the Q&A box on their interfaces, and we will incorporate as many of those as we can into the discussion. Brian, it would be great if you might begin by spending some time sharing with us some of the thinking you have been exploring through the current pandemic regarding the future of education in this country, including what sort of system we should be shaping and also the consequences of a more lax approach. Over to you, Brian.
Thank you very much. I very much appreciate being back, Anton, and to all of our guests today. Thank you for taking what I know is very valuable time. This is an area of passion for me, as you might imagine, running a university. But it is an area where I think the future is both uncertain and the path that we should be taking unclear. So I really do hope I'm going to put out some ideas and what I think is happening. But as forever, in my world, things are meant to be contested and more than happy to have conversations on things that people think are very interesting. I'm someone who always tells it like I see it, so appreciate if we don't have the conversation on the front pages of the newspapers tomorrow, because for me, I want to really have a rich conversation. And these really are a conversation of ideas rather than, in my opinion, dogmatic facts. So I'm going to share a screen with you, which will take through things, and then we'll have a chance to hopefully have a dialogue afterwards. Thank you very much. So let me share my screen. All right, Anton, is that good?
Very clear.
Excellent. So, as Anton said, let's talk about the future of higher education. So 2020 is, I think, going to be seen as an inflection point for higher education. But let's reflect on that inflection point. There was a massive overhaul of Australian education in 1989. And since that time, there have been changes made, but they have not, they've been changes at the edges. And so I would contend that we've had a largely unchanged higher education system from a structural point of view. And during that time, the participation rate in university has climbed to nearly 40% of people who are, you know, by the time they're 30, they will have gone to university. But another maybe not so good side of that is the participation rate in TAFE and VET has been dropping. And I think the whole view in some sense the what people think of TAFE and VET has declined, and it's been deinvested in. If you go through and just look at what you can expect as a student, is that pretty much in any degree, you get a strong economic return for your university degree still, over, for example, TAFE. There's a few things where it's pretty close, but generally speaking, the universities give you more money in your future. To give you a sense what that is, if you do a degree right now, you will typically make, whether or not it's science or humanities, about $500,000 extra in your lifetime than if you didn't go to university. You did a TAFE or just a straight high school. And that includes everything. And that's work that Andrew Norton has done, among others. Andrew was at Grattan, but he's now at ANU. It's great to have him on board, being able to go and think and do a lot of the analysis that I think through. Universities, of course, don't just teach, they do research. And I think that's often forgotten. And indeed, whenever you hear the discussions in the media, the research part of universities is almost not discussed. Gross expenditure and research funding as a share of GDP has fallen from 2.25%, peaked in 2008, and is now down to about 1.79%. About two-thirds of that is in the business sector, and government and business tend to go up and down together. There's no magic genie where you get business suddenly to pay for everything, or if you just have government pay for everything, it's very, very expensive. University R&D amounts has more or less stayed flat over that entire time, 0.6% of GDP, but more and more of it has been funded by international students over time, and less of it by government. I guess it's quite interesting that to think what's happening there. It's not all bad. We complain about it, and it does put us into some great gross strategic risk. But universities are funding their discretionary, and which are largely research activities, through international student fees. During that time, Australian university research outputs have risen dramatically. Now, I don't know why it is, but let me give you some examples why it might be that might be true. The actual cost of me going out and getting a grant from the Australian government is about a 30 to 40% cost. That's how much money I spend to get a dollar back in a grant. It's expensive. Lots of time, lots of support, lots of compliance. Plus, I don't get to choose strategically what I invest in. I do what grants get up. And so it tends to be a bit here, none of it connected up. When I get money from an external source like philanthropy or international students, I get to invest that money exactly as I want, align it to the strategy of my own university. And so I think one of the reasons our outputs have risen dramatically is actually because we have had this untied funding coming in that doesn't have a big set of overheads of it. So just throwing money through the grant system is maybe not the solution. If you're at other universities, I'm sure there's some here, that will be a controversial statement, but it is something that I note. The 2020 pandemic has set a shock through the higher education model, not yet realized in most universities, okay? We have had increased students in 2020 at most universities, but then decreased by COVID-19. At ANU, we made a decision a couple years ago to flatline the number of students at our university, and so we were over the level of students we wanted, so we decreased a bit. Turns out that was a really bad set of timing for us because we decreased our numbers at the end of 2019 and then had that compounded by the COVID shock. So our numbers are going to be among the worst in the sector. But what happens in 2021, 2022, 2023 are all going to flow through the sector. We lose students in 2020, everyone has, and it compounds effectively with interest over time, as you lose more and more students, as the pandemic goes on, and it leaks through for 3 to 5 years. Our master's students, typically 2 years in Australia. Our undergraduates, typically 4.5 years in Australia. The China market at its current scale is also in doubt, and anyone who doesn't think it's in doubt is, I think, naive. I have some of the best experts in Australia on China. I also have access to government in ways that other people don't due to proximity and our conversations. And I am the most pessimistic person in the sector about the China market in the future. Now, I may be overly pessimistic, but there is a lot of downside risk there. A lot of it's going to be due to competition, not just within the US, Canada, and the UK, which I think will be tremendous in the competition there, but also China itself. And I think we see many avenues by which China will be prepared to make a point by not forbidding students coming to Australia, but making it difficult. And I think that is a very likely set of things to occur in the years to come. And if it doesn't happen, it's always a threat for the future, and one we need to be thinking about, because our universities, as COVID-19 has shown, with almost everything that has allowed us to combat COVID-19, whether it be in Australia or the United States or in Europe, coming one way or another through the university system, sometimes through companies, but the basic research coming through the university system. Unfortunately, it was research done for the last 20 years where people would ask, what good is that? And the answer is, we're not sure. Well, mRNA vaccines are a good, you know, they're absolutely fundamental change. The protein clamp out of UQ, which will be resurrected, another one that came out of the basic research. So from my view is, I think most universities will have a significant contraction in their budgets, and then flattish, possibly rising if we're lucky, possibly falling if we're unlucky. And then there's always the chance of a major geopolitical shock. Another shock that's occurred is the technology one. Students have seen what digital can provide, as have for-profit and the education providers. And our students at ANU, can I say, are very keen to come back on our campus. That's what they signed up to. But not all students are going to be like that. And I expect to see 4 modes in the future for universities. These are what I say, modes for university or university-type organizations to deliver content. High-volume remote digital. So this is getting people as inexpensively tooled up for what they need in life. I think a lot of the world, if we're going to educate literally everyone in the future, that is going to be a very important mode to do it. Now, it's not going to solve, it's not for everyone. It's probably not going to create the future great physicists of the world, for example. May not be great for people who need the relationships to start, you know, high value businesses, although some can emerge out here, but it's going to be a really important part. But it's going to be done on a cost basis, and a university which has really bad cost structure finding itself in there is going to be a place where good luck. That's not a place I want to be. But a lot of universities are going to find themselves, and I'd say half of Australia will find itself competing in that market. I do think there's going to be a niche of smaller scale remote digital learnings, potentially with optional intents on campus. This can be research led. It'll be in niche areas where literally for-profits or mass stuff just isn't appropriate. It's really getting in to the experts and having active interactions like we're having hopefully today. And for places like ANU with campuses, you might have people come together so they actually get to meet and form the relationships as part of that course. So that's certainly one ANU will be looking to, and I think that will become a much more important thing for Australian universities. Harvard already does this in spades. And Australia will start to do this much more. But it'll be a prestige brand type thing, would be my guess. High volume on campus. You flog your campus for a while, all that it's worth. You use your prestige as best as you can, but you really, it's a high throughput, relatively low touch on campus. That is what I would say a large fraction of Australia is doing right now. And it will probably go with the high volume remote digital. It can be research led as well, although the trick that people normally do is they do research and those researchers never participate in the teaching. And you have teaching staff that use the campus and the prestige of the university, often do an excellent job teaching, and you pretend that it's research led, but it actually isn't. It's really a high volume on campus experience taught by teaching professionals. I think that will continue to be attractive. As someone who's inside, I would expect a big discount on that relative to other things on campus, but right now there is no discount. So we'll see what happens. And finally, I think there will continue to be, and this will be a small part of the Australian market, high touch, low volume on campus. So this is the mode that ANU does, but it's also the mode that, for example, Bond and maybe Notre Dame and Divinity College in Melbourne all do. It can be research-led like ANU does, but it doesn't have to be. It's sort of the Bond is probably the best example where they really spend all of the tuition fees on, you know, really giving students a great time on campus. And I think that's likely going to be a niche that will be important going forward, especially as some of the big people in the middle here get squeezed become less attractive over time. Lifelong learning is going to become more important. You're going to hear until you're sick of them, micro-credentials, executive ed, one-year masters. They're going to be ones that are entirely based on just people who can teach it well. I think for-profit providers will be big in this space because their cost structures are really good, but then there'll be a place for real research-led expertise in there as well. Industry-specific education, perhaps even delivered by universities, such as courses provided right now in Australia by Microsoft or Siemens, I think will be really important where people, you know, if you want to get accredited to get a job and work in, for example, Azure by Microsoft, they provide courses. And indeed, many of ANU's competitors deliver those courses that are actually created by Microsoft. Now, I don't think we will do that because we see that is something we would rather just hand off to Microsoft. And I fully expect Microsoft and others, Siemens is doing this, to go direct to the students at some point. Why go through the university, especially when you have the brand of a Microsoft or Siemens? It's going to be highly competitive in this space. For-profit providers will be out in force in all but the prestige areas. But there's something here for everyone, and everyone's going to be looking to this to give themselves a chance to upscale in what's going to be a much more competitive job market. The government directions. And this is my reading of what is coming out of government, and it's not meant to be hyperbolic or anything. But the basic message I'm getting is, as a member of the university community, is with respect to the international students, you got yourself into this mess, fix it yourself, i.e. we're not going to give you any new money. All right? They keep telling us that translating research for economic benefit is imperative. The acceptance that research is a long grown thing is said, but I don't think is believed by most people. There are definitely insistence that students need to be work ready. What that means is interesting. Do we have to make them work ready for a specific institution? So there's a lot of innovation going on there. I think that's not a bad thing. And they keep telling us that foreign interference, IP theft, academic freedom are really, really important and will be highly regulated. The fact that they really want to regulate academic freedom has a certain irony to it. But I will say there are some issues around academic freedom being undermined at our campuses that I find worrying. And I don't think we have done any of that at ANU, and I will fight to the death on it. But the idea that I need to be regulated to do it the way the government of the day wants, when I think they have nothing to say we've done anything wrong, is not cool, but it's the way life is. Foreign interference is a serious issue, but I think the reaction to it has been all over the place and counterproductive in many places. But I would also say many of the universities just ignoring it is also counterproductive. IP theft is not a big deal within universities. IP theft is really important in companies. And so I think it is interference with our students and democracies and stuff that I'm more worried about, foreign interference. And yeah, a little bit of IP theft. But if you're going to have IP theft, you're going to do it by sending and training PhD students and them going home. So what are the dangers for the existing universities? I do think if I were a smaller university, I would be worried about prestige universities like myself, although ANU is not big, but Sydney, UNSW, Monash, Melbourne, crushing small universities by massifying the throughput through their campuses, using their prestige to suck up everyone, and literally drying up the revenue of the smaller universities. I'm not convinced they give them better educations by this mode, but as someone who watch how dollars flow right now, this is the easiest way for domestic students to make money. I think if we do that, for-profits are going to see an opportunity to come eat our lunch. They're going to take over that prestige university using prestige to essentially extort rent on students. For-profit providers will see the rents, and they will come in, and their cost structures, they're not going to pretend to be research-driven. They're literally not going to be doing any cross subsidies. They're just going to come in and do it better, do it cheaper, if that's the type of thing you're trying to provide. So I think people are going to try that because they've gotten away with it thus far, but I think there's a lot of danger there. Australian universities, I think, are likely to lose their luster compared to our international competitors, because ultimately we're going to have less money per student available from all of our funding students relative to other jurisdictions, which are more highly reliant on domestic student fees, as in the US, or government, also as the US and Europe. Some of the universities are not going to make it. They're not going to be viable. I also think Australian research productivity is going to crash as our funding dries up. We are unique right now in the world of research systems that are productive that use student fees to pay for much of our research. No one else does that. I mean, there are bad parts of the research system that do it. Australia is the only high-class research system that does this. It's great if you can get away with it. I just think the COVID-19 is going to bring that to a rapid end. So what are some ideas? And I'll stop on this. I think going forward that the government should have the expectation, just from a nation building perspective, but also for productivity, that everyone is going to need a tertiary education in some form. But not everyone's going to need the same tertiary education. And we need real market and price differentiation. You can't just be one size fits all. If everyone is going to have a tertiary education, then you might want to make base tertiary education free, like VET. But I would also describe, the pedestrian's a bad word, the high throughput undergraduate, which is massified but appropriate. That maybe should be free, because the idea that there's a special return no longer applies, which is one of the reasons HEX exists. You could use HEX then to differentiate the market to more premium courses, master's degree, research-led, undergraduate educations and stuff, and have people being able to move back and forth. Now, I can imagine I probably have some for-profit entities on today. The one thing I will say, happy to discuss, but income contingent loans kill price signals. And every time income contingent loans mix with for-profit entities, bad things happen. So we need to come up with a system, in my opinion, that uses the good parts of HECS, doesn't crush for-profit teaching, but I don't think income contingent loans can just be willy-nilly put in to for-profit entities. The vet, bit in a decade ago is an example of what happens. And you can regulate the crap out of it, but what's the point then? I do think we need to have a much more diverse range of universities with respect to mission. And that means further concentrating research around excellence, research-led teaching. Not everyone in the country needs research-led teaching. We need it, but not everyone needs it. It needs to be a premium product. And we need to get around the fact that we can have high quality teaching universities. And because those are appropriate for, the average person, that's what they need. But it doesn't mean it's high throughput, low. It can be sort of the liberal arts college model, the bond university model, but having, more mainstream, I think. Why not have interoperability between vet and universities? Why have them be separate? It's bad. I should be using vet to help with my work integrated learning. That's what they're experts at. And their cost structures are 5 times cheaper than mine. But in not just, when I say interoperability, I don't mean just course credits, but also funding and things like work integrated learning. It is nuts to have the nation's future through research funding rely on international students. Research funding needs to reflect the needs of the nation. After World War II, the Allies realized that one of the main reasons they won that war is ultimately they had better research than the other side. And, whether or not it was penicillin, the nuclear bomb, radar, cracking the Enigma code, cracking all the Japanese codes, those are all based on university-led research. And they knew that. It was existential. Now we've sort of forgotten that this stuff is necessary. Student fees should be used for education with a minimum of cross-subsidization, some, but not a lot. And I do think you have to pay a premium if you're going to get a research-led education as part of it. Industry policy needs to be sorted out. We do not have an industry policy that incentivizes universities and industries to work together collectively. It's sort of a stick on the universities or a stick on the research, but you need a system. You need to nurture existing research-led companies. You need to create research-led companies, which are few and far between in Australia. And that's the way we're going to boost productivity. If we're going to have a decent vet system, it needs to be deeply connected with industry, as it is done in Europe, rather than to be this add-on thing that is 20 years out of date, run by the states. It needs to be invested in, and it should be something we are proud at. And as I said, the ability to move from vet to university, et cetera, should just be part of the system. So those are some ideas of, I think, how we can fix things. Not all of them particularly expensive, but they do require political will, which is not in strong abundance. Anton, over to you.
Brian, thank you. Thank you very much for a very comprehensive look at, I guess, some of the key priorities and issues and challenges facing the sector, your own institution among others, but also, I guess, in recognition of the diversity of the ecosystem that actually does make up the education sector as a whole. I think your comment towards the end that, following from World War II, the recognition that at that time research was existential. I mean, there's a lot of talk these days about existential risks and what constitutes an existential risk. Is it the future of artificial intelligence? Is it climate change? But classically, existential risks were referred to, the existence of risks to the state in terms of security, because we didn't really have that many other forms of existential risks that were so apparent to our everyday worldview. So I think that's a really strong reminder of while we see the debates on research going on, that it's not necessarily always quantifiable, the outcomes of good research, as you made the point, excellent research being required rather than just everyone doing it. But it's something that may not be immediately measurable, but for which we need to recognise the qualitative, if you like, existential components of research as well. So that was, I think that's a really strong point that it would be good for everyone to take away. If we can go back to that foreign interference, foreign affairs point, that's obviously something that's coming up regularly in the media, in terms of not only the university sector, but foreign interference into a range of businesses and organisations and parts of the society considered vulnerable, both in terms of the IP theft you're referring to, other economic intelligence and sort of keys into interfering in our democratic processes. Do you want to outline just briefly what the university is doing? Is there an aspect that of compliance that's being considered too burdensome from government? How do you see that specifically? What needs to change?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is an emerging threat. 5 years ago, it wasn't really on the radar. We knew about Russia occasionally coming through and creating havoc. And you know, things have changed in the last 5 years. What we have seen is some geopolitical tension, and what we are seeing is people are realizing the power of cyber threats, among other things. So let's look at cyber and foreign interference. So the big worry was initially on IP theft. So IP theft is real, but it as I said, if you want to steal someone's IP, it's good to have it in fully functioning form with engineering drawings that create a product of value. Universities do the underpinning work that require an expert to then translate into anything of value. And they're, you almost have to be an entrepreneur then to make something out of it. There's a reason why universities don't have big companies on them. We're the wrong place for it to occur. So there's an aspect there, and we need to be concerned that we don't undermine our security. I will be honest, I actually think that's a second order threat. My big concern is what I saw in the US and the UK with interference in elections and the whole notion of truth, that truth undermines our democracy. And I talked about this in our State of the University address. And at the same time, where the whole notion of truth is become contested and contested by people who are deliberately manipulating information to create essentially propaganda on all sides. This isn't one side, everyone's learning to do this. Universities and the press and government were the places that used to curate the information. That curation has been lost, especially in government and in the press, whose trust rankings in the last one were less than 30%. Universities are still up at 75%. So at least people still trust us. We haven't been corrupted yet. Now, we got to make sure then we help. Not we should take over the press or government, but we need to lend a helping hand. Mm-hmm. And that's where foreign interference has come in. That foreign interference has actually been used to undermine the trust in our democratic societies. And the U.S. is a great example at what happened in 2015, 2016, of a deliberate campaign to polarize the American public, which has been amazingly successful, far more successful than anything that happened in the Cold War. Remarkable. It scares the bejesus out of me. That's really important. And that's happening in a microcosm on our campus, where our students try to be manipulated by all sorts of people. And we need to be a place, if we're going to be that trust place, we need to keep this safe. And that means making our systems safe, so that people can express views and not be undermined through ransomware, through attacks on their families, at home, et cetera, et cetera. So that is the place where I think the foreign interference is really problematic, but we don't talk about it that much. That's the big risk for us. And With respect to the government, the government's focusing on, you know, the IP theft and the foreign interference manipulation of research. That is the second order issue. A little bit happened, we're doing lots. I put in huge amounts of effort to make sure that we work with agencies to understand the risks, and we talk with our researchers, and we are adjusting. We didn't do that 5 years ago. We're doing it now, and I think we're doing it very well. But that's where the focus is, but they're missing the point. That's not the big game. The big game is our democracy.
Very good point. The issues around research and, I guess, the picture you've painted about what a future education system would look like or ecosystem would look like in this country and how that might be funded. Obviously, the points you're raising around foreign interference, some of the issues around lack of awareness of the benefits of research or the value of education and et cetera. One of our online questions, Brian says that actually refers to your presentation as a brilliant analysis, but asks the question, how can we make the transition to this system? Like, sometimes it's not a matter of implementing policies of all these aspects sequentially. There are other obstacles in the way. But what's your view on actually how do we get from where we are now in 2021, still in the pandemic, to this picture of a healthier education and research ecosystem in Australia?
So, but my honest answer is it's going to require courageous political leadership. The switch in 1989 by the Hawke-Keating government was incredibly unpopular, but they just did it. And I think there was a lot of good there, but there was some bad there. I think they destroyed the vet system in their changes, and that was a mistake. Anyone who's tried to make little changes along the way, it just doesn't happen. It turns out if you try to just do a wholesale new system versus making one substantial thing, the political cost seems to be the same. So I think it's going to require a education minister backed by cabinet to go through and say, we need a new system, nose to tail. It will be fiercely opposed. I will probably oppose it too, because it'll screw my life up here at ANU. But the reality is I don't see us making the transition easily, bit by bit. If I had to choose something there, demanding interoperability between vet and universities would be an interesting start. But the problem is VET is a state-based enterprise, and it will get confusing on that front very quickly. I think part of it's going to happen due to the economic shock of COVID-19, what are we going to do when suddenly we have a bunch of universities going under? Don't know. And finally, just the for-profits are going to come in and disrupt the sector. And so I think we may find a system that's untenable without reform, and so it will kind of make government have to act. But I think you just need to go and do the big vision, quite frankly, whatever it is. These are ideas, but someone's going to have to own it. Incremental change has not worked.
Okay. It's a lesson in change leadership in a way. It's something not only that needs to be done at an organizational level, but for the country.
Well, you can sometimes nudge things, and I'm trying to nudge ANU. COVID-19 has been a bit of a nudge, more than a nudge. But I'm not convinced there's a nudge in this place, because it's actually a big structure that needs to change. And you just can't do it bit by bit.
Mm. We have an online question that goes into the processes of education itself within the universities. And I guess this is across many of them. The question is, does a research-led intensive model, as you were describing, imply that senior research staff running tutorials should continue? It says that research-led lectures might as well be mass lectures. Does a true research-led intensive model require a material shift from the historic business model in which a lot of research-led teaching uses relatively junior tutors with limited research experience? What are your thoughts there?
So I actually think the way Australia does it right now is certainly not the way it worked when I was young. So we've kind of morphed onto a business efficiency model. So I think a perfectly viable way is lectures, as I've said again in my presentation here to my staff, they need to be, the lecture isn't necessarily dead, but it's got to be, as I said, like the Pink Floyd concert that you want to go to, rather than if it's just the same as listening to, you know, Dark Side of the Moon on a CD, then what's the point? So I do think if you're going to do lectures, there's some, you got to make them wow, and they got to be performative probably, rather than anything else. And that's a good thing. That's part of the excitement of knowledge and getting really inspired. Interactivity between students and research-led staff is essential. And you're right, getting up and having a person, you know, basically reading out of a textbook, which is how the Russians used to do it. God, I can tell you, Russian lectures back in the old day were just awful for that reason. That's just bad. It always was bad. Now we know how bad it really is. So let's put the lecture online if it's not performative, and let people do it digitally, and then have these interactive sessions. Now, those interactive sessions can be scaled up so that you have young PhD students who are part of their education, and they are experts and know a bunch of stuff the old people don't know, are part of that conversation, that research process, with the older, wiser people involved in as well. So you can create an environment that is research-led, but it has to be active. The students and the staff member need to be interacting. As soon as it's passive, let's put it on digital and massify it.
You were making points during the presentation around prestige institutions, prestige areas of research and learning, and you know, many very interesting comments around the connection between universities and VET and VET and industry, presumably also industry and universities. But with this focus of on your sort of government direction slide around the focus on economic outcomes, also the sort of focus on employment and employability. What are we losing with a focus that's so skewed towards that sort of employment-based education or those short-term, immediate economic advantages? And I wonder whether part of the misunderstanding of the benefits of research are based around a temporal misunderstanding, a sort of focus that's often a point of criticism in our societies more broadly of our short-term focus rather than long-term focus that we might require to actually be more strategic as a nation overall. What are your thoughts on the sort of bias towards employment, industry and economic outcomes?
Well, you know, if I were a student, I want to get a job at the end of it. The problem is the logic is we need to be more focused on employment. Therefore, you should do less of the education and more of the training. So that does not necessarily follow, right? Yeah. We are, as human beings, our brains are not getting any bigger, and the ability to digest the complex set of information, which is becoming, you know, more and more. If anything, our students need longer in that education, figuring out how to think and get their head around the base set of skills and knowledges. But whenever we talk about work integrated learning type things, they say do less of the previous and do this because we're thinking it's a fixed mindset. This is a 3-year degree. That's how much money we have. That's it. So I think there are real problems for many people on that approach. Not everyone, it's the appropriate thing. I mean, it is possible to get overeducated compared to what people are interested in or their talents. But I do think at the same time, we shouldn't just discount the idea of work integrated learning. It's very valuable. And you can just see the employment outcomes and things, and they enjoy it. Mixing it is good, but don't think you can do both without extra resources and extra time. So that's where I think the mistake is. So, and the other thing is, I think that vocational education is all around the relationship with the businesses. Why not start normalizing that relationship and have ANU and, you know, Canberra Institute of Technology work together? And, you know, that's unheard of. Why would you do that? Well, it's all in our minds, because there, you know, we can do that, and you need the people working in vocation and the researchers all working as a team downstream anyway. Same way medical education, you kind of want your nurses and your radiologists and your doctors working together, even though they don't really get educated much together. It's kind of foolish. So I do think there's some places to make some big gains here that are just completely off the sites right now.
I know a few years ago you were trying to remind business that the Australian, the level of collaboration is in Australia between the university and research sector and business was actually at the bottom of the OECD league tables for that collaboration. Do you think there's been much improvement? And if not, how do we get to the point where we take away the mindset of not being able to collaborate between these educational institutions, let alone business, and actually how do we get more collaboration is my question.
So, I mean, Chief Scientist Alan Finkel was a little critical on the analysis of that data set, but I'm not going to go into that. I think, though, the interactions are still poor. Now, part of it is how many research-intensive businesses are at the top of the ASX, okay? The answer is about 5. CSL, ResMed, Cochlear, it's not very many of them, okay? So we don't have a business sector that has huge research capability. And because of that, it's kind of hard to have conversations. So we are learning how to have those conversations. We're getting better at them, but it takes time. I think creating new research-led companies, that's what we're trying to do. And so I, you know, announced that I wanted to create a unicorn every 5 years, first one by 2025. Why do I want to do that? Because those are going to be research-led companies that are naturally easy with me to work with. Okay? And so I've got sort of 2 in the can that I think are over 500 million now. One hasn't been valued yet, but it'll be soon. And a couple more in the pipeline. That's a good thing. And everyone wins if we can do that. So we really do need to create a bunch of research-led companies. And we have capital, we're beginning to get expertise, and I can see my numbers growing over time. And so I think there's going to be some real good stuff there, but it would help if we had a better industry policy on that front. I think that finally, I'm very strong on having industry PhDs because we need people who understand universities at the research level embedded in companies. And the best way to do that is for the government to invest in PhDs, strong programs, because that will give us someone to talk to. So that's my number one easy to do thing.
Yeah. And with that, your comment earlier about the grant system not being the solution, like, what do you have a view on what the options might be generally for research-led funding or research funding into the universities? Presumably, there's a public component of that and potentially also an industry component of that. What are your thoughts?
So I think that we do need grants, but they on themselves are not an answer. You need grants. Universities need to have some block grant funding that they put to use. Right now in Australia, uniquely, when we get a grant, I have to go find about 70 cents on the dollar for the grant to pay the overheads. Plus, I told you it cost me about 30 cents on the dollar to get the grant. So it's kind of forward and backwards, right? So I do think we need to tune that up a bit. But ultimately, what you want is a highly competitive granting system. But the university is having a little bit more strategic money. In the U.S., it's done through philanthropy. You know, Harvard's got $1.6 billion a year to spend. That is a lot of money. That's U.S. So I think we need to come up with a system that gives us our best research, but it can't be everyone's a winner. You really need to focus on where the big stuff is done. And that's just one form, but we should celebrate the other forms of parts of the university that are not necessarily doing research in that sense, that sense all the time.
And this connection between industry and research, the university system, not only in Australia but globally, has been very open and collaborative. And just to that foreign interference point, one of the online questions asked a question about how that research funding's going to come about. The question is, do you think the worry about foreign interference will impact the ability of researchers to collaborate across North America and Europe and apply for international funding programs? Will it cause a shrinkage back to just Australian government funding for Australian research? Obviously, a lot of the money comes from elsewhere as well.
Yeah, well, it has, through stupid regulation and over-regulation, it has the possibility of poisoning the well. So we have been very much on that. And so I do think that will be sorted out diplomatically with our allies, but it may cause us a couple years of pain and consternation. And I'm unfortunately the vice chancellor right now. And I would like to quite frankly hand that problem off to someone else, because it's just sand in the gear wheels of what we're trying to do. So I think it's unnecessary. I do think it will be resolved, but I think more interestingly enough is with the likes of China, but also other emerging places of capital that may not be, or research money that may not be our allies. There's a lot of great things we can do together. You know, we can work on new immunotherapies with China, and there's no strategic bid. It's for common good. We are going to poison that. And if we decide to do that, where there's nothing about us as our security, just because we decide we don't like this country,
yeah,
really are going to hurt ourselves, because no one else is going to be that stupid to do that.
I think that's a really important point, Brian, that when you're looking at diplomacy and the relationship between countries goes across a number of dimensions. And just because you have issues on one or two of the dimensions doesn't mean you write off everything. I mean, diplomats regularly engage in art diplomacy, sport diplomacy, all manner of forms of diplomacy. And I think that's a really important point. One of the questions goes to the issue around productivity in the sector as a whole. The question is, EdTech and cognitive science have made huge advances over the last decade. So our ability to improve educational outcomes is real, but the center of gravity of most educational institutions hasn't moved and is far from this leading edge. How can we inject more EdTech innovation into education for better outcomes?
So I was just talking to my staff about this, because we know we don't have the ability to do this. And the reason we don't is due to highly complicated systems that have been layered together for the last 30 years. So this is a place where for-profits, which quite frankly don't have to go through all the stuff we do as a university with bizarre TEXA regulations and things, which are there for good reason. It means we're pretty glacial at actually underpinning the technology you need to use this. So I actually think we know we need to move into the ed tech and cognitive sciences. We're going to be slow movers because of the complexity of our organization and our systems. And what's going to happen is the for-profits are going to do it, and they're going to force us to do it, because we're going to realize they're going to completely eat our lunch if we don't. So I actually think competitive pressures from the for-profits will do that well. And then there are up-and-coming universities that do it well, and they provide the pressure as well. But it's not that we don't need to do it. It's just hard. And it's one of the problems of one of these big behemoth battleship research universities. Our systems are complicated.
There's another question online, looks at the diversity of what an ecosystem might look like for education, and poses the question back to you, whether a high quality teaching university can also be a top research university. Are these things mutually exclusive?
I hope not. I'm, and that's Simon. So we've talked a lot about teaching. And so, no, absolutely. I think we can have really high quality teaching within a research university. I think we need to be prepared to have pedagogy experts embedded and help our researchers be better teachers. I think we can have programs embedded in a research intensive university that are entirely non-research led, but are literally teaching in that. I think we can do that as well. We need to be very open and transparent about when we're doing that. So indeed, those are all the little tricks that I would like to do now. But universities always hark back to, but in 1080 in Bologna, this is the way we did it. And so they're slow to change. And COVID-19, the one good thing is it's given us a catalyst to change quickly. And so for me as a leader, if it doesn't destroy me, which it might, I need to make sure that we catalyze and try to get these things that are very slow moving in a university to happen now so that we're ready for the future.
Mm. Okay. We have a few minutes to go. There's a response to one of the other questions on the types of research funding as well. I guess drawing that point around industry and university collaboration, and whether we need, how do we get beyond the mindset of the distinction between pure and applied research, and that grant funding favours pure research more. Do you have a view of how that balance should be structured?
Yeah, so that's Joanna, and nice to see her making the transition from IBM into Monash. Sorry we don't have you up here at ANU. And I say that as a vice chancellor who has a Nobel Prize in the most fundamental stuff you can. People like Joanna, who can move between the two, are incredibly valuable to the institution. We will start talking about the heroes who are doing this across the industry. It takes time because, you know, right now I'm a snapshot. The average age of my academic is probably about 50 at this institution. So they were brought up where people who weren't any good were forced off into industry paths as a way to keep them busy. That is the way people thought about it 30 years ago. Right now, that is not the way we think about it. I'm looking at my best researchers moving back and forth. And my big worry is I'm going to lose a lot of my best young guns to industry. And so I want to make sure I have the ability for them to move back and forth quickly. And I think it ultimately is telling the stories and making them their work heroes, just like winning a Nobel Prize and discovering, you know, the expansion rate of the universe back in time. I think they're equally heroic activities. So I actually think we're on a trajectory, but the latency is 5 to 10 years. And the worst place for me, my bloody promotion panels, which are still antediluvian in their views and routinely knock back people, which as me as vice chancellor just drives me nuts. But vice chancellors are not dictators, and I have to go through and get the whole place going. So it's moving, it's just slow. Yeah. But Joanna, it's great to have you in the university system.
And interesting also you saying that the model of the hero or the rock star researcher at this point in history is, you know, has changed somewhat from maybe what it was 50 years ago.
Well, even 10, that's the point.
Yeah.
The problem, though, is the university is a filter of about a 50-year time back in history. And we're what, you know, so that's good. That means we provide a bit of a safety valve for the world, but it also means we're very slow to evolve.
Hmm. Do we need to look at other countries that are doing this better, or should we just, you know, for once, look at some first principles, fundamental principles of what we want to be and just work it out for ourselves?
I think Australia is a very specific country. We are an economy of 25 million people, heavily isolated. I actually think we would be wise to start trying to collaborate a lot more on the research front with, either a network on our side of the world, or the European Research Council has invited us to be part of what they do in a very sensible way. I think trying to pretend that we're going to be this little island that just does what it can in this ever-going world. I think we're going to put ourselves into a big risk in all sorts of ways, and we will learn then from other countries. I think we need to find our own way at some level, but I think we better be a lot more collaborative, especially in the research space, because I don't think we can just do it as Island Australia anymore.
Mm. Well, I don't think we need to go into too much detail about what Australia starts to look like if we don't do some of these things that, you know, are calls for strategic reform in education. But thank you once again, Professor Brian Schmidt, for joining us today and sharing a plethora of insights on the future strategies needed by the sector as a whole, both for policymakers and for all the leaders of institutions and businesses in the sector. And also all the businesses in the wider economy whose individual organisational futures will too depend on Australia getting its education sector and its business models of its institutions fit for purpose for, I guess, what is the radical uncertainty that we all face at this point in history. Thanks, Brian.
Cheers, and thank you, everyone. Thanks for coming along.